Thank you for tuning into Stranger Advice. My name is John Zaskota, and I'm your host. Sit back, relax, open your mind to any new possibilities, because the beginning is near, is near, is near, is near, is near, is near. In episode 6 of Stranger Advice, we speak with documentary filmmaker, intuitive, and Project Camelot co-founder Kerry Cassidy. She provides a brief look into the evolution of her career, shares a few memorable experiences, and describes the evolution in what has become a leader in the area of whistleblower testimony. Hosting Awake and Aware, a Project Camelot conference being held September 23rd, 24th, and 25th at the Irvine Hilton in Irvine, California, she provides details about this life-changing event and welcomes you to attend in person or by live stream at home. We pick up the interview with Cassidy now. So if you asked my guest this evening to tell you a secret, she'd probably ask you which one. I'm joined by Project Camelot co-founder Kerry Cassidy. Kerry, thanks for joining Stranger Advice.
Very happy to be here.
Project Camelot's become an international sounding board for whistleblower testimony, and no doubt you've learned and experienced a lot more than the average person in a lifetime. Can you tell our listeners about who you are and the overall mission of Project Camelot and a little of its history?
We started Project Camelot back about 5.5 years ago, and initially I was a frustrated filmmaker. I'd hit a glass ceiling in Hollywood. I'd been working in Hollywood for about 19 years. At that time, I was packaging independent productions, sort of trying to put together sci-fi projects and pitching them to people like Ridley Scott's story person or Kathleen Kennedy, who worked with Steven Spielberg and other people like that, and James Cameron, his story person. And I was shopping around a project called Wingmakers, based on wingmakers.com. It's kind of a cult website. You can go to it and find it on the web. And it's a multimedia story, but the basic story behind it is that it's a black project. About a scientist who's on the run from having worked in a black project, and how, you know, these ETs and so on. So it's all about saving the earth and whatnot. So at that moment, I wasn't able to sell the project, even though in my view it was a very, very good project. So I just basically got frustrated and decided to pick up a consumer grade camcorder and go down and start attending UFO conferences and interviewing the speakers, asking them if they'd seen a UFO. I just thought that would be a lot of fun. And as it happened, I had incredible luck. I just had a great rapport with the people that I met. And I shot it guerrilla filmmaking style. I was, I had a background in filmmaking, and I'd gone to UCLA Extension Film School. I was a writer, producer, director for that project, for this short fiction film program. That's kind of how I got started, and I met Bill Ryan because he became my partner in the Camelot, and he was working as a webmaster. He had volunteered to be a webmaster for the Serpo.org project, and what he basically did was put a bunch of information, communiques, from this person called Anonymous, which in the end was a DIA source, Defense Intelligence Agency source, who was leaking information. And there turned out to be a lot of information, and a lot of it did turn out to be disinfo as well. But at any rate, he created a website and did it quite efficiently. And so he became kind of the only spokesperson for the Serpo project. And I was on a news group with Bill. I was reading the communiques and basically asked Bill for an interview. And so that's how we met up. I went to the Laughlin conference where he was speaking. I did an interview with him. I just thought he had a great attitude at the time, and he responded very well to my questions. And from there, we kept in touch when he went back to England, and I went to Egypt with a group that was investigating the signs of Atlantis in Egypt. And on the way back, I stopped over in England, and Bill had promised to show me Tintagel, one of the former homes of King Arthur, and Stonehenge and other power places in England. And so we went to Tintagel, and it was there that we both had very strong, you might say past life memories, whatever, influenced by the King Arthur legend. And we were impressed by the utopian ideal of the round table that was a non-hierarchical sort of model for society. And so we took that as an inspiration, and we right then and there decided to create Project Camelot, and that's where we came up with the name. We put Project in front of Camelot simply because in Black projects, as many people will know, they use the word project before a lot of their top secret projects. So we thought that might be kind of fun. And also you couldn't say Camelot because there'd be 100 million Camelots on the web. So at that point, we created a website and we set off to interview whistleblowers. We both wanted disclosure. We both wanted the truth to come out about the Matrix. And as it happened, we had incredible luck. And at this time, we have over probably 300 hours of video and audio footage and on our site. And it's like a library, really, of whistleblower and witness testimony across the board, with authors, you know, people that are experiencers, engineers from Black projects, ex-military, you name it.
What a great story about Project Camelot. You've had so many great experiences. What would you consider to be the most powerful experience you've had since you've been doing the show?
Oh, God. You know, that would be really a difficult thing to address. I mean, I have to say, during those years, even up to now, it's been a very magical journey, if you will. In many ways, I think we became so popular because, and we have such a large following, because we kind of brought the viewer along with us on our journey. And because, again, we were shooting guerrilla film style, we didn't stand on ceremony. We basically traveled the world as best we could, flying to places on a dime, basically. And we stayed for fairly cheap in you know, places. And Bill had this really old Audi, and being English, he was able to, I don't know, it comes across the channel on a boat, and then you drive into France. And so we were able to drive around in this old Audi that he had, this station wagon. That was unbelievable. And we went to Italy, and we were able to drive a lot of places, which I guess in some ways saved us money. And then we also flew, you know, wherever we had to. And Bill had grown up in Africa, so he was also an experienced safari guide and so on. So we used to go on safari when we took a break. And that's where the cheetah, if you want to know, you know, the cheetah, which is our logo, that was a nod, sort of a tongue-in-cheek nod to MGM Studios. You know how they have the lion roaring. Well, and the idea of the cheetah was that we were faster, being the internet, than the MGM lion. And we were also, you know, it's the eye of the cheetah watching you as the powers that be watch us, so to speak. So a lot of people ask that question because there are so many different experiences. I can't really cite any one experience as being sort of major. It's just, you know, and it isn't over the top in the sense that we are always, we were interviewing people all the time. Every time we got an interview that we thought we'd never get, it was very exciting. There were things like when we first tried to interview John Lear, he gave us a really hard time. We had to arrive in Las Vegas really early in the morning. We called him up. You know, he kind of gave us the runaround. And basically, we kind of had to snap to it and show up on a dime wherever somebody wanted us to. When we got to, we wanted to go to